Paratech, being approximately 10:45, I'm going to open the public hearing on House Bill 1546 and call on Representative Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, members of the committee. For the record, I'm Representative Robert Hall. I represent Grafton District 9. I'm here today to introduce House Bill 1546, which amends the New Hampshire wiretapping statute, allowing the recording of public servants by allowing parties to a conversation to record conversation without criminal penalty. HB 1546 will bring New Hampshire's wiretapping statute in line with the Glik decision, which was the First Circuit Appeals Court decision, where a gentleman by the name of Simon Glik, a private citizen, filmed Boston, Massachusetts police officers making an arrest. When they noticed him recording them, they arrested him. In a unanimous decision, the United States Court of Appeals for the First Circuit held that the officers violated Mr. Glick's constitutional rights, and the officers were not entitled to qualified immunity. The court ruled the right to film public servants in public places was clearly established. Boston reached a settlement with Glik in which they agreed to pay him $170,000 plus attorney's fees. This was the first case the United States Circuit Court of Appeals explicitly ruled that a private citizen have a right to film police officers in public places. The case drew media attention across the United States. It was also cited favorably by other United States Circuit Courts of Appeals that reached similar conclusions in other cases. New Hampshire's wiretapping statute does not have an exception for recording public servants. HB 1546 amends the statute by adding an explicit exemption. HB 1546 also adds exemption wording to several other statutes, specifically the disorderly conduct statute and the obstruction of government administration statute. It's RSA 642 and RSA 644:2. They're poorly worded statutes, which basically the offense is subjective in nature and is frequently used as a catch-all to effect an arrest. By adding the recording exemption language to these statutes, we'll make it clear that recording is not an offense. New Hampshire has a problem with public servants not adhering to the decision in Glik. As you will hear in other testimony, police officers are currently arresting individuals for recording them. This results in expensive litigation and settlements, the cost of which is ultimately borne by the taxpayers. The actual actors do not suffer any penalty. HB 1546 addresses this problem. In addition to explicit exemptions from criminal statutes for recording, this bill adds a criminal penalty to those who violate the right to record. If a person interferes with a person recording public servant in violation of a person's right to record, they would be subject to criminal sanctions. This would be in effect deterrent to the continued practice of arresting or interfering with citizens for recording. And in addition to the criminal sanctions, HB 1546 establishes a cause of action for injunctive relief under 91-A, which is New Hampshire's open and accountable government statute. The injunctive relief would be available in addition to any criminal penalty imposed. In the event the criminal sanctions were not available, any person aggrieved by having their right to record violated could pursue civil remedy in Superior Court under 91-A. HB 1546 also removes the criminal penalty for recording a conversation to which someone is a party to. Currently, under the wiretapping statute, someone can be prosecuted for recording the conversation they are participating in. There is no reasonable expectation of privacy among the parties to a conversation. Parties to a conversation know they're communicating with the other parties, and it's entirely reasonable for any party to a conversation to have an objective record of the interaction. I ask that you vote OTP and HB 1546, and I thank you for your time and attention.
Questions? President Martin.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank you for your testimony. I have a question, probably purely technical in nature, but going with the definition of a public service by performing a public function, a government function, wouldn't it be true that once a police officer or any city or town employee clocks in for the day, they're performing a government function as long as they're on the clock?
Yes.
Follow up?
So if someone wanted to film a police officer on his lunch break, if you've not signed out, would that technically be allowed?
I guess if it's not a secure area, it would be allowed.
Representative Mangiapudi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. Would it also include public school teachers? They are public servants, city hall workers, and non-law enforcement.
Well, the Glik decision also includes that the right of reporting is subject to reasonable regulation. So I think that you could exclude certain areas from public view.
Follow up.
My concern would be public schools, especially in elementary and middle schools. Often the teacher could come out of the classroom to talk to the parent or talk to the student in the class. And if a parent is walking by, oh, I know the kid, that's a kid, did something to my child, I'm going to report that he or she was outside the classroom. So wouldn't this open up opportunities for misuse of public servant being on camera all the time?
I don't believe it would, because public schools are already restricted access, not public places per se. In other words, the general public just can't walk into a school. They have to be granted access to the school.
That's not true. In a public school, you can, even if you don't have a child, if you're a citizen, you could be in the school building with, for some other, you know, I don't have a child in my elementary school, but I go in to read to the kids or volunteer. So there are others that go in will have access to it. So that would be my big concern.
Representative Cuomo.
I believe the FERPA law covers school and school children for their privacy, correct? Thank you.
I have a question, and it's just going to be a very simple one. On page one, line four, the change basically eliminates the two-party requirement in the state of New Hampshire and then turns it into a single party, because the way it's worded, it says at least one party to the communication. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Thank you. President Burke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Representative. Do you know how many states have one-party consent?
I don't know exactly, but I originally hail from New Jersey, where virtually everything is legal. They allow one party.
Thank you. I have a position paper, which you haven't seen, of course, from the state police, and they opposed the bill. Would you have any speculation of why? Just to hear it from you.
I don't.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Cordell Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Cordell Johnston, representing the New Hampshire Municipal Association in opposition to the bill. I recognize the Glik decision, and I don't think there's any question any longer that a private party has a right to audio and video record police officers when they're performing their duties in public. But this goes way, way, way beyond the Glik decision. Under this bill, and I guess the part that concerns me most is at the bottom of page one, starting at line 27. All public servants shall be subject to audio recording, blah, 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 by any person while the public servant is performing a government function or any activity related to a government function. As Representative Martin asked, would this apply to any city or town employee once they punch in and they're on the clock? Answer, yes. It would apply to any legislator when you're talking to any other legislator. This would allow someone to come into the governor's office and record her conversations of more concern to us. It would allow them to do the same thing in the mayor of Manchester or Nashua or Dover's office. There have been bills in the past that tried to codify the Glik decision, which were, in our opinion, fairly reasonable. They made it clear that you could record someone in the performance of their public function as long as you did so, as long as the recording device was plainly visible so the person knew they were being recorded, as long as it was done from either from private property or from public property that is ordinarily open to the public, and as long as you don't interfere with the official performance of his public function. This doesn't have any of those limitations in there. So there's no protection from the person doesn't have to know they're being recorded. They could be recorded in their office where the public ordinarily does not have access, and the recording could interfere with their function. It goes way too far. Glik is the law of the land. If people are violating it, they're violating the law. If the legislature feels a need to codify the Glik decision, I think that's fine, but this doesn't do it. I'd be happy to try to answer questions.
Representative Robertson.
Mr. Chairman, I've been in public office since my early 30s, and I can't recall any time that I would be embarrassed or worried about being recorded. And the only thing I can think of was when you wouldn't want to be recorded is when you say something that the public ought to know.
Is there a question in there somewhere?
Yeah, why would you be for this?
Why would we be against this?
You're a public person.
Yep.
And if I'm talking to one of my constituents.
You may believe that, but I suspect that most public officials and public employees would have an objection to having their telephone conversations recorded, having their office conversations recorded. If you don't have any objection to that, then you're for the bill. That's fine.
Representative Mangiapudi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. Would you believe this public servant also has several roles? I can speak about myself. I'm an elected official. I have no problem and I'm representing myself as a state rep, but when I'm representing myself as a mother, I wouldn't want those conversations with my child.
Is there a question
yes.
in there somewhere?
So the different roles, so there is no privacy in terms of a public servant. How would a public know if I'm working as a public servant or my role is as a parent when I'm in a public space?
Well, that's a good question. I don't think the bill would allow someone to record you while you're talking to your child, but that would require them to know when to turn the tape recorder on and off. I think that it just creates a nightmare.
I'm going to jump in here in just a second. Like I asked the other witness before you, on line four, it says at least one party consent. That eliminates the two-party consent rule in the state of New Hampshire, which means as long as I want to record you, I can record you at any time, doing anything at any place. Would you agree with that?
Well, if you and I are having a conversation, you can record that. And I think that's less a concern for the Municipal Association from our perspective, but that is a huge change to the wire web.
Representative Burke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. The New Hampshire AG's office is now going to investigate the voter fraud in New Hampshire because of Project Gericke, James O'Keefe's group.
Right.
I'm assuming they didn't have the consent of those people in Portsmouth and Hanover that they recorded. How do you feel on that?
Not that familiar with, all I know about that is what I read briefly in the, I think it was in the Union Leader this morning. If it's based on conversations between two, I should say the Municipal Association doesn't have a position on the issue of recording, if you and I are having a conversation, whether I should be permitted to record that. And I think that's the kind of situation that you're talking about. That's not really, I think that's a privacy issue for private citizens, and that's not our issue. Our issue is about recording of government officials and the performance of their job. So I'm not sure that we have a concern about the issue you're talking about.
And just one follow-up. Thank you, sir. Well, these were elected officials at the ballot, you know, place in Portsmouth, Hanover, and I think there was one other, you know, that were showing people how to kind of skirt around the law. And because of this, and because of their taping, you know, do you disagree with their taping, you know, these people not knowing that they're being taped, but now the AG is looking into the voter fraud system?
If these were public officials,
yes,
having a conversation with voters or purported voters at the polling place, which is a public place that the public has access to, I don't think we have a problem with that.
Thank you. Thank you. I like that. Thank you.
President Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. And I've been thinking about this question carefully in an effort to, when I ask it, I don't aggravate the chairman. There's that phenomenon, I don't know if it's a phenomenon of paparazzi. You basically stalk celebrities, and it's, you know, they refer them as stalkerizing now. In New Hampshire, from time to time, there are these little feuds that go on in the town between individual citizens or groups against the public officials, the police, the fire department. Does this more or less open the door to that someone stalking public official under the guise of the conditions of this bill?
I don't know. I think maybe you can already do that. I mean, I don't know whether there is someone here from Keene, but I know there has been an issue there with people following the meter readers around, and the courts have basically said they have a right to do that. I think they already have a right to do that. But this goes well beyond that. This would allow you to record them not in a public place or not in a place where the public ordinarily has access. This would allow you to record them in their office or anywhere else, and that's our concern about it.
Thank you.
Representative Como.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. You would agree that a public servant takes an oath?
Yes.
That's established. Is it not true that public servants are already responsible for everything they say and do? And if that's also a fact, why would you oppose that? I would think that if they decided and took an oath to be a public servant, that they give up their right to be completely private, that everything they do is under that scrutiny. Would you believe that to be true?
No. I believe that you may believe that, but I would not agree that everything that they do. I believe that public servants, whether it's legislators, workers in a town office, school teachers, whatever, there are many, many, many situations where they have private conversations that they have a right to expect would not be subject to public scrutiny.
Follow up. A public servant is being recorded, for an example, in a tax office. They're performing a duty that they're supposed to perform. So if the interaction between the two people is being recorded, that's reality. You're not changing anything. So I'm still confused why that would be opposed.
I guess I'm not understanding the situation you're referring to.
A public servant.
Yep.
You're interacting with a tax official. You record that interaction.
Yes.
It's reality. So what is the fear of the recording if you're just recording what's actually happening? I don't understand the opposition.
I'm not sure that I can give an answer that would convince you. But again, I'll reiterate that I believe there are many situations where a public official or a public employee has a conversation that they have a legitimate expectation would not be subject to public scrutiny. It might be a conversation between two legislators on this committee. There's innumerable situations where I think that would be the case.
Can I have another follow-up?
I'd just like to point out that we only have another 7 minutes left in this hearing, and I have nine more people that
want
to speak.
I'll pass. That's fine. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Chris Casco.
Thank you, Chair Thal, members of the committee. For the record, my name is Chris Casco. I'm an attorney for the Department of Safety. I hold the position of Administrator of the Bureau of Hearings, appearing opposed to HB 1546. Our position is primarily based on the fact that we think this legislation is unnecessary in light of the Glik decision. The Glik decision already says there's a First Amendment right to record a government official in a public place. Glik also says that the recording is subject to some time, place, and manner restrictions. This bill, we feel, is too broad in that it would have some unintended consequences. Just a little bit about history. There have been a few bills in recent years that have dealt with the subject of audio recording. Most recently that we've dealt with in 2014, House Bill 1550 allowed for audio recording. That bill also had some restrictions in it. That bill went to interim study, and it was concluded to be not recommended for future legislation. So we think that supports not going forward on this bill, especially given the rights that Glik already provides. And in 2010, there was House Bill 1501 that went before this committee that would have allowed audio and video recording in a public building. There also was another piece of legislation that year, in 2010, House Bill 1372. What the committee did in House Bill 1501 was to ITL, because the study committee in House Bill 1372 was already going to look at the issue of the wiretapping statute and whether or not there needed to be any changes. That study committee also looked at the recording of a police officer in the course of their duties. And in the final report, the study committee recommended making some changes to the language in the wiretap law, changing definitions to make them more modern. However, the study committee report reflected that it did not support a broad authorization allowing recording of police officers, because that could compromise officer and public safety, and that the committee did not want legislation that would result in a bill that may hinder an officer's ability to control a crime scene or to control a traffic stop. So the problem with HB 1546 being as broad as it is, there really couldn't be any restrictions, even if a restriction would compromise public safety. Another scenario that we have concerns with are some meetings that otherwise would be subject to a privilege, like attorney-client. Let's say in my job, I have a meeting with our counsel at the Attorney General's office on how to deal with the case, and we have a conversation that's privileged under attorney-client privilege. This bill would allow for the audio recording of that meeting, and it would totally pierce that attorney-client privilege. It would take it away because we're government officials. Both myself and the lawyer at the Attorney General's office would not have that privilege because it could be videotaped and then would be subject to disclosure. The same thing in the scenario of an EMS provider providing treatment to a patient, if they were a government provider like a Concord ambulance, that could be audio recorded and cause a breach of the privilege that that medical provider would have. Same thing at New Hampshire Hospital. If a doctor is providing treatment to a patient because that doctor works for the state and is a government official, that would not be protected. And the other problem with this is the government official would be subject to prosecution if they don't allow the videotaping. So they would have to have a very difficult choice. Do I violate doctor-patient privilege or do I violate this law and be subject to criminal prosecution? So for those reasons, we object to the bill and recommend that it be ITL'd. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Representative Robertson, just remember we only have like 5 minutes left in this hearing.
What I don't understand is I'm talking to you and I offer you a $500 bribe and you accuse me of it. I never did that. Or you said to me, you give me $500 and I'll do it. And I accuse you. And they say, oh, come on, he's just trying to...
Is there a question in there somewhere?
Wouldn't you want conversations where you're talking to the public or another official who is in a position to ask you to break the law or threaten you with... Wouldn't you want it all recorded?
I think it would depend on the nature of the meeting. If it was during a public hearing, certainly I'd want that all recorded. It's subject to be recorded under Glik now, as it should be, and that would be recorded. However, if I was having a meeting with someone and we were talking about their driver record, which is protected under driver privacy, I don't think that should be subject to being recorded, because to record that, it could then be disclosed, which would violate that person's right to privacy.
Follow up. But you're the only two people there.
We are, but if it was recorded, then that could be disseminated to other people. It could be on the internet, and that would compromise that person's rights.
I understand, but there are two people there. I can disseminate it later if I didn't record.
This is much better taken up on the executive session than it is here, because like I said, right now I have one more question to be asked, and what's going to happen is, unfortunately, under the rules, I'm going to have to recess this hearing and open the next hearing coming up. So
I'm looking for the rationality of the reason.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Real quickly, would you be willing to sit down with me to draft an amendment to allow certain recordings, for example, a traffic stop so people in Ware won't be arrested, in other areas, you know, to help pass this bill? Would you be willing to sit with me and do that?
I would be willing to meet with you. I don't know that we could support any type of amendment. We don't think this is necessary, so I don't know that. But certainly, I do.
Well, if you could drop your parent off, I would like to meet with them.
Sure.
Thank you.
I'll reach out to your representative. I'll send you an email with my contact information. We can get together.
I'm going to ask one real quick question. It's the same one I've asked everybody else. Based upon the language in this bill in line 4, it doesn't eliminate the two-party two-party recording statute in this state.
Yes, I think so.
Thank you. Unfortunately, I hate to do this because there's a lot of people who want to speak. However, under our rules, we have to start the next hearing on time. So what's going to happen is I'm going to recess this hearing, and it will be opened at the end of the day after the last hearing.
Will you let people not from the state testify then?
Yeah.
Yes. Anybody can come in and testify.
Why don't you do con in a row?
And then close it. Yeah.
The hearing is closed.
Public should be heard.
Or not closed, recess.
Approximately what time would it be?
2:30 to 3.
I'll tell you what I'll try and do. If we can get done with the next hearing before, say, 12:30, I'll open it again at 12:30. That'll give people a chance to come back and testify. I'm just limited on how I have to run things. Okay, it's not that I'm trying to keep anybody from talking.
Continue with the public hearing on House Bill 1546. And I don't think everybody is here that the sign has. I'll read the cars off and they're not here, we'll set them aside and if they fill up, we'll speak. Ann Rice, the AG's office.
Well, Representative Welch, she asked me to text her when you open the hearing again.
Anybody?
She asked me to text her when you open the hearing.
All right, that's it.
I'll send her a note.
How is it all wrong?
He didn't know.
David Crawford, the team. Brian Hawkins.
Chairman, members of the left of the committee. In the interest of time, I was just going to say we agree with the assessments made about the final section with respect to how a public servant is defined and that being too broad to apply to other professions, not just with law enforcement, but other public servants who serve the state that have issues with private conversations, sensitive private data. And so we have a concern about that and happy to work with the committee if we're going to continue to work on this bill.
Okay.
I do have one question.
Who are you with?
Oh, sorry, the state employees.
All right, I am going to work on an amendment, so you can contact me.
Good.
All right.
Thank you. Wanda Dewey.
Yes.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
I think I've seen you before.
Just a few times. Actually, I came here very early today specifically to speak on this one just because that's what I believe in. I don't have any clearance from my board, so I'm not saying that I'm representing them. What I do have is my son, who went into prison with an eighth grade education, attention deficit disorder, and hyperactivity. He came out, and one of the things that program taught him was to always back up what he was doing, to check and make sure he's doing everything right. And so the first place that we had to go was to the parole officers.
Oh, excuse me. Are you testifying?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, I am. Hold on.
All right.
So the first place we had to go to was to the parole office. And I asked to go into that parole office with my son, and they would not allow it. He's straight out of prison. He's a big boy. He can take care of himself. So, okay, so I didn't get to go in. Subsequently, when he would go to parole, he asked if he could record what they were telling him. He has attention deficit disorder. He does not remember things. He was not allowed to record. He was not allowed to bring anyone into that parole office with him. So he has nothing that he can go back on to make sure that he's doing what he's being asked to do. They were so paranoid that my son was going to record them that when he went into their office with EEGs surgically glued to his head, they ordered him to remove them, and he refused. In refusing to do that, they could put him back into prison. What are they so afraid that he is going to record? We typically, and I've spoken with Department of Corrections, I've spoken with Department of Safety, my son has spoken with DOC, Department of Safety, our local police department. I have this little device right here that I leave on the desk, and I record here. My son says, "My name is Joseph Brooks, and you're speaking on a recorded line." I've never heard one police officer say, "No, you can't record me." And at that point, I'm very comfortable speaking with that official because I know that they're going to do what they're supposed to do. And if they don't do what they're supposed to do, we've got proof of what we said and what they said. Please pass this law. I remember back when it was a one-party consent, back in the 80s. If I'm on that phone call, I have a right to have a record of what I'm saying and what's said to me, especially if it can affect my life, and in my son's case, his freedom.
This is a suggestion. If you experience that same thing again, sometimes a note from a doctor will make all the difference in the world.
Sir, they haven't. You want to know what made the difference?
What?
Helen Hanks.
That works too.
No, Helen Hanks, Department of Corrections. He still is not allowed to record. And I still believe that he needs the right to be able to record 2 days later when he doesn't remember. You saw my son testify. Did you realize that what he said wasn't consistent in when he was talking? Because his mind wanders, and he had a computer screen in front of him. If your mind wanders and your life and your safety and your freedom depend on it, the department should not be allowed to stop him from recording. He needs it. It's a disability, but we can't even prove it. And they don't care. They're a public servant. My taxes pay the paycheck. Let me in there with my son, or let him have my little recorder that's not hurting anybody. And yes, that's behind closed doors.
I have the opposite problem. I have a granddaughter that lives with me. She's autistic. She remembers everything.
Yes.
Sometimes.
Too much.
Any questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If Joseph Brooks would put down the bill number?
I didn't hear it.
1546.
This is the earlier bill, 1546.
Okay, so I did submit one. Right, this is the recording one that we got suspended.
Yeah.
You want to go talk?
Am I up?
No, not yet. Ann Rice.
Oh. I very much appreciate that.
The state has to come first.
So, shoulder surgery.
Okay.
Thank you.
Welcome back.
Thank you. Nice to see you. For the record, I'm Ann Rice. I'm the Deputy Attorney General. I am appearing in opposition to this bill. We completely support the policy of government transparency and accountability, which is clearly the basis of this bill. However, I think that the language of the bill itself is very expansive and really creates some problems. So I'd like to go over some of those with you. There is no question that the Glik decision, which you've heard reference to earlier, allows for the recording of public servants in public areas. But that right to record is not unlimited. The Glik decision made clear that it could not interfere with a police officer's duties. And it can only be done in public places where the public has an unlimited right of access, which in that case was the Boston Commons. Excuse me. Since Glik, I think that you're aware, our office issued a law enforcement memo to all police departments in the state informing them of the Glik decision and the fact that public recording is allowed. To my knowledge, there have not been problems since that time. I know that there was a problem certainly in Ware early on. I am fully aware that the new chief is well aware of that policy now. So I think that we've addressed that. But House Bill 1546 does not contain any limitations in terms of this right to record. It doesn't say anything about where the recording can take place, whether in a public area or a restricted area. It doesn't say that the recording can't interfere with a public servant's job. The right to record is not limited to conversation to which one is a party. It would allow recording of interactions between a public servant and a third party, even if the recorder wasn't involved in that conversation. Section 1 of the bill amends the definition of the criminal offense to say, to eliminate it being an offense to record if you are a party to it, or if one party consents to the conversation. But that's different than Section 2, which says it is not unlawful under this bill to record a public official. It has no limitations. So the testimony that you heard earlier, or the questions, is presupposed that it has to be someone who is involved in the actual conversation with a public servant. This bill doesn't say that. So if that's the understanding, and if that's the desire, this bill doesn't do that. And I think that's very important. It does not define public servant in any way. There is one different definition in the statutes, in the criminal code, under RSA 640:2, which defines a public servant as any officer or employee of the state or political subdivision thereof, including judges, legislators, consultants, jurors, and persons otherwise performing a governmental function. I'm assuming that the intent is to probably be that broad, although I have real concerns about saying that jurors, acting as jurors, are public servants that can be recorded. They should not, no recording should be allowed in the deliberative session. So the language of the statute is very broad in that sense. There is no requirement that people be told that they're being recorded. And I really have to question why not. Is the intent of the bill to trick people? Or is this the intent of the bill is to be able to make sure that people are behaving as you would expect a government, a public servant to? I think it's only fair that someone be told that they're being recorded. And there's nothing in here that suggests that. The bill would create conflicts with the enforcement of the right to know law and certain confidentiality laws. As I said, the way that it is written now, it is an absolute right to record a public servant. It doesn't say you can't record when there's confidential information being disclosed. It doesn't say you can't record in non-public sessions of a select board or something like that. So those are all concerns that this bill would raise. It does not define where recording can take place, nor does it allow for imposition of any restrictions. Public servants work in all sorts of places. In my office, we have a public area where people come in. That's clearly a public area. We have a reception area where people are allowed after they get through a secure door. And then we have the secure back area of the building. Does the right to record include all of those areas? This bill would suggest that it does. And I think that that's very concerning. One of the things that I think about oftentimes is a district court office of the Division of Welfare, where people may have to go in and have discussions with caseworkers and things like that. I don't know in every situation how those offices are structured, whether there is an ability to have a confidential conversation with someone that's not in a public area. I hope there is. But I think that we need to consider that this bill is not just public hearings like this or the clerk at the DMV desk, but it would include any time that a public servant is functioning in their official function. And I think that there needs to be some definition to when and where that can take place. Although the bill is intended to create open and transparent government, I really do have some concerns that it may have the opposite effect. I think in New Hampshire, and we've just seen this with the primaries, is government officials here are very accessible to the public. And I think that is one of the great joys of being in New Hampshire. But the prospect of being audio recorded is intimidating to a lot of people. And it can be particularly intimidating if you don't know if you're being recorded or not. So I think that it may cause some public officials to become reluctant to engage with the public, even in routine encounters. Much of our government is made up of volunteers, people who volunteer their services to the government. All of our, our licensing boards, those are all volunteers. And I have a great concern about being able to recruit people when we're imposing these kinds of laws. I am not saying that a licensing hearing is not a public hearing that can be recorded. Absolutely it is, but this goes far beyond that. So for all of those reasons, I would urge you not to pass this bill in its current form. We would be happy to work with the committee if there was a subcommittee formed on this, but I think the way that it is now, it's extremely broad. I'm happy to take any questions.
Well, before we get into that, Representative Burke is going to be working out a couple of folks here have indicated a desire to work with him. So Representative Burke will be the contact person?
He will be the subcommittee chair?
I guess he is. Right now he's a single person on that, but I'm sure we can get a couple of folks to help them out.
Hopefully I can get some friends.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. My concern was very specific, like what you mentioned, it's a vastness. Would you believe that there would be a lot more unintended consequences of tripping people up who are public servants, who are volunteers, and they're not, you know, the role of a public servant versus a private citizen can change in an instant if you're in a public place?
I think that that's, yes, I would believe that. I think that the lack of definition of a public servant is one of the critical things. And the fact that people aren't being told that they are being referred, I do think that it can trip people up in a way that could make it very uncomfortable.
Follow up, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Would you believe that this is almost like trying to tag, to find fault with the public servants? That's how I'm perceiving it. And would discourage a lot more of citizens to participate in a voluntary, and our state runs on volunteer public servants.
Yes, I would believe that and I would agree with it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Taking the other side, if I'm talking to you, I hear you. My brain records what you said. But if I tell somebody else and you say, that didn't happen, it's my word against yours. The only reason I can believe I would be afraid of being recorded, or you being afraid to be recorded, is if one of us said something that was wrong.
Oh, I don't think that that's the only reason that someone would be afraid. I think being recorded can be very intimidating. I am used to it now, but I can tell you 10 years ago, it was not a comfortable thing for me to have to come into this room and know that I was going to be recorded. You get used to it. But for many of our government employees, being recorded is not something that happens all the time. And it's intimidating.
Okay, I don't understand it.
Okay. Look,
thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you. I'm trying to think how to say this. Project Veritas, if I say that word right, James O'Keefe people. Mm-hmm. For years, we've had voter fraud in New Hampshire. The New Hampshire AG's office has said, no, it doesn't exist. But now you're going to investigate because of these tapes. Do you feel that these tapes, that these people did not know they were being videotaped, do you think they're useful today? Because now you're looking into this.
Are they useful today in terms of voter fraud?
Well, now that the New Hampshire AG, if I may, Mr. Chair, that now the New Hampshire AG's office, if I read the papers correctly in the news, is going to investigate voter fraud that has been happening in New Hampshire for years, now you're going to take a stand that you're going to look at it. And I think you're looking at it because of these tapes.
Well, I'm not going to comment on ongoing investigations, but I think you may be reading that a little incorrectly. I think that if there is voter fraud going on in terms of people giving false information to election officials, I think that's a very important thing to learn about.
Okay, and a follow-up?
Follow-up.
In these videos, the elected officials were given a spin on how to beat the system. Say, okay, if you don't live here, just say you live here. You know, isn't that useful to know that these elected officials in Portsmouth and Hanover are doing this?
I think that is important information. I'm not sure that the way it was done is appropriate or fair. And that's as far as I want to go, because it is an ongoing thing. I understand what you're saying.
All right, and just one last follow-up.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. How do you feel on all the volunteers in 38 states, D.C., that allow one-party consent?
H- how do I feel about all the volunteers? I'm not sure what you mean.
You know, they have all, you know, I'm from Vermont, and we're set up almost the same, except for they get paid a little bit more to be a state rep than I do.
Everybody does.
But they're basically volunteer legislators too. But they have one party consent over there, as well as 37 other states in D.C. So, I mean, if it happens in 38 states and D.C. and it works okay, why not New Hampshire?
I don't know that it works okay, but the big concern that I have had, and I think, I hope that I've expressed this, is this isn't just one party consent to someone that's involved in a conversation. Because you're a public official and you are talking to a constituent, this would allow a third person to walk right up and tape record, regardless of whether either of you consents. Why is that fair to the constituent?
Why not?
I think it is. Because the
you
elected,
think it's fair for the commission?
Because the elected Sorry. Official is being videotaped, it, you know, I just feel any time is appropriate.
I appreciate your stance. I think we have fundamentally...
I guess I would have to check on the 38 other states on if they allow that third party to sneak in.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. Yeah, I guess my question goes beyond the recording. You know, if I do something and say something stupid, elect on me, and somebody catches it, that's, you know, good for them. But what happens to these recording pictures after the fact? A little bit of malicious editing, and I can you can make the reading of the Gettysburg Address sound evil. What are the protections for a public official who's been taped and then his comments have been edited and put out there maliciously?
I think that that's a concern with all of the access to recording now. I think that's a great concern. And I don't think it's just for this bill, but we see it all the time with kids and things that are being recorded with kids, and that gets posted on the internet in an internet and in edited fashion. So I appreciate the question. I do think it's a concern. I don't think it's limited to just this bill.
Thank you.
No further questions. Thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you.
Now, we've got 8 minutes before the next hearing starts, and I've got quite a few cards here. So if there's something, if you have written testimony, if you could pass it in and maybe summarize it or do something, otherwise we're going to have to recess it again. Travis Pack, do you have written testimony?
I do not, sir. And in the interest of time, I'll waive my right to testify and let
right.
someone else come.
You can turn in your testimony if you like and be part of the
yes.
record. Daryl, is it?
Harry. I will be incredibly brief. Representative Byrd, I do have some suggestions on the bill that I will email to you that I think alleviate some of the concern. I think a couple of the sections here could be removed, and what I consider to be the main portion of the bill would stay intact, and that would be making New Hampshire a one-party consent state, as 38 other states plus Washington, D.C. and federal law are. Now, there have been suggestions that people would just randomly film state reps or elected officials eating a sandwich. And as a journalist, I have to say that I absolutely have zero interest in filming such a thing. And of all of the journalists I know, I can think of maybe one or two people that call themselves members of the media that would film such a thing, and probably only because they were bored and had nothing else to do that day. Now, Representative Birch, you keep asking questions about Project Veritas, and I realize that the Attorney General's office had said that they are going to investigate, but they have not said exactly what they are going to investigate, and I have to speculate that they will investigate whether or not Project Veritas committed a felony for surreptitiously recording. And that's something that, again, as a journalist, I am interested in, because where I'm originally from, Birmingham, Alabama, several of the news agencies there do hidden camera investigations. The one that sticks out in my mind the most was WBRC Channel 6. They had six on your side to where people could call about businesses that were defrauding people, ripping people off, and they would have an investigator go in and catch someone committing fraud on tape. If that were to happen in New Hampshire, that would be a felony. The investigative journalist would wind up possibly going to prison for several years. And that, I would say, is an absolute shame that real journalism is basically illegal in New Hampshire. So we definitely need to become a one-party consent state. And I was reading over some of the statutes in various other states. Arkansas, Hawaii, and I believe Indiana all have very similar wording that says it is neither eavesdropping nor a violation of privacy to record a conversation to which you are a party. So if you're involved in the conversation, you can record the conversation. And that is really the main aspect of this bill as far as I see. Because section one of the bill would change to at least one party. And if you leave that, and I'll just go ahead and summarize the change that I would make if I were to amend this bill, I would strike section two and section five.
Hold on a minute. We're not going to be talking about amendments to the bill because the bill, that is not before us. The bill. We talked to Representative Byrd afterwards because he's going to be subcommittee chairman.
Yes. What was just stating, those two that I would repeal if I were in your shoes, and it keeps the single party consent and then just clarifies that certain things are not disorderly conduct, certain things are not obstruction of government administration. So the bill is good. I think that a couple of tweaks could make it an even better bill and would alleviate the concerns that have been expressed by the AG's office, the Municipal Association, and several other bureaucratic agencies. And I'll take any, one more thing before I say I'll take questions about malicious editing. I host a radio show, and there are things that get said on live radio that someone could go out and edit to make it sound like I said something absolutely stupid. And there's actually a soundboard on online where you can do a Google search for Daryl Perry soundboard. And there are things that I've said that just a little, half a second snippet makes it sound like I'm an absolute idiot. And there are things that journalists write that if you take one sentence completely out of context, it could make it appear as though they're an absolute idiot. So you don't need to say, well, if we can just randomly record public officials, somebody will edit it and make them look like an idiot. Well, all of these hearings wind up getting recorded in some fashion. The discussion on the floor of the House gets recorded. Somebody could go through that and pull out a snippet and make any single one of you state reps look like an absolute fool. So if the only objection is malicious editing, I think that's a very weak objection. So I would urge you to, again, pass this bill and I'll answer any questions.
Isn't it a little easier to detect somebody editing a recording rather than my brain?
Yes.
What I repeat from my brain, which is edited?
Yes.
Thank you very much. And again, in the interest of time, of 2 minutes.
I can make mine in there.
Oh, what? Excuse me. What was that guy? Kala?
Gericke.
All right. my ears work a little better than my mouth does on that.
Thank you for hearing my testimony today. I'm here testifying as myself. I am the incident in Weir from 2010 that also went all the way to the First Circuit Court of Appeals. I was charged with wiretapping. My decision, and I'm actually not going to stick to my script here because I want to get time to address some of the issues that were brought up. First of all, to Attorney Rice, who I believe left,
and all the state employees who got the chance to testify first with a lot of time. And of course, here we are down the wire. Unfortunately, she's not here, but the question that I would love the committee to ask her is Article 8 of the New Hampshire Constitution, which is the supreme law of the state, states that government, therefore, should be open, accessible, accountable, and responsive. There are no carve-outs, there are no exceptions, and that's pretty much what this bill is trying to do. We live in the 21st century, there are recording devices. If you're on the job and you're a public servant, you're on the job and you're on the record. It is that simple. I hate to say it, but really your personal feelings about how you feel about it, it's not relevant. You're a public official who swore an oath to the New Hampshire Constitution, and that requires you to be open and transparent. 38 states already have single-party consent. It's not a big deal. If the Department of Homeland Security can say to us, as citizens of this country, that if you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to fear, then I'm going to say to you today that if you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to fear from this bill. You should be on the record if you're a public official. I would urge you not to start down the path of diluting this. I have testified in front of several committees here for 5 years on this issue. I first came to the legislature when my court case was going on. Nobody wanted to help me. They said, no, try it in the courts. We tried it in the courts. I won. It cost the taxpayers of Weir tens of thousands, $57,500. It wasted a lot of my time and a lot of the town's time. And there's the case in Keene that also went all the way to the New Hampshire Supreme Court. So you guys have an opportunity today to actually put this to rest. Otherwise, I would say over time, we'll just see more and more and more lawsuits, which cost the taxpayers money. It wastes everyone's time. And you know, this state gets a D minus for integrity, according to the latest reports, and that was reported on NHPR. So let's do something about it. On the job, on the record. With regard to the issue of malicious editing, that's a non-issue. If you're worried about that, you have the right to also record the conversation. If it's between two parties and someone comes in, that person can ask. And if there's an opportunity where someone is wondering why they're getting recorded, there's probably a situation where someone wants a record of it. So either the official can say, yes, you know what, you're here to help me out. I do want this on the record. Or you could make your own recording. Or the constituent in that case could also consent to the recording. Let me see if I covered everything I wanted to say. Oh, this is very important. In my case, the court found that because of the Glik decision, the officers do not have qualified immunity. Now, as everyone in this chamber probably knows, qualified immunity is a public servant's get out of jail free card. It's the one where you can say, for all of us, ignorance of the law is no excuse, but if you're a public official, apparently you're allowed to say, well, I'm the enforcer of the law, but yeah, I didn't know what the law said, so sorry, oops, my bad. In my case, they said, you can't do that anymore. So unless you guys figure out a way to make a bill that's good, on the job, on the record, what will happen, as there are more lawsuits, public officials will not be able to claim qualified immunity. So if you get filmed somewhere, you know today, because I'm testifying on it, that as a public official, you can be held personally liable in the case if it goes all the way up the chain of law command, right? That you can be held personally liable because you know that we are allowed to record you. So all I have to say, if anyone has any questions, let me know.
If there were a provision in this bill, they recorded a conversation between yourself and, let's say, some law enforcement officer. If both parties get a copy of that recording, there should be no problem.
Well, yes, but I think actually, I'm obviously an individualist. I think if you want a recording, that's great. I think if you're a public official, I love the bill that said people should, law enforcement should start wearing body cams. I think that's helpful. Certainly in my case, there were body cams and cameras in the police department that didn't work that night.
And when I subpoenaed them, or subpoenaed the records to prove that they had fixed the cameras that hadn't worked, there were no records that they were ever fixed. So either someone was telling a tall tale, and I know it wasn't me. So basically, I don't think people should be so scared of this idea. We live in the 21st century. These things are recorded anyway. And it's just a modern way to keep everyone on the up and up. It's really an opportunity for you guys to embrace something that will ultimately make your life better. Unless, of course, you have something to hide.
You know, honestly, I've had an experience with a selectman in my town some years ago, where we had a group come in with a, trying to return a $500 check that the town had given this group. And we returned it because it was a charitable group, and charity is not, charity is when you give your own money, not when you give the town's money. And we went through this whole thing, and one of the selectmen went out of his gourd, swore, and there was a recording device up there. And he knew about it. The next morning, I was over at the town hall, and he says, "It was a recording device." I said, "Yes, it was." He says, "Can I get a copy of it?" I said, "I suppose, but I don't know who did it." Later on, I came back and I said, "Well, this was the recording from the civics class at the high school." End of story. Representative Mangiapudi.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for taking my question. This bill is intended only for the members in this chamber or the elected officials. I wouldn't have any problem. The unintended consequences that I'm looking out for any public servant, it's beyond legislation, beyond police officials, beyond court systems. We, in this state, have public servants that are not under any of these categories. They do not have any awareness or, you know, we are putting people under scrutiny for no reason, but it's more making everybody a hair-thin trigger of lawsuit. That is just, that's what, you know, I'm looking at this as a broad sweep, dragnet of things. So would you believe that this is a dragnet?
I would like to address that by saying the definition of public servant as it's written in this bill comes from another law or another section of the law. It is not defined originally in here. So somewhere in the wisdom in the past, it was decided that that is what a public servant is. So if that's the definition of a public servant, then surely we should use the definition of a public servant. So it's not truly great being overbroad. It is actually just using the language that already exists.
No further questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for your testimony. All morning we seem to have heard everybody approach this as a negative thing. Would you not believe that this is a positive thing to show the good that public officials do?
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think it's an opportunity. This is a way for New Hampshire also to be sort of a groundbreaker and to say, are we, as it states in the Constitution, are open and transparent. So really, it's an opportunity and it's a way to show the good. And filming police officers, for example, I see it as just witnessing. Someone can make an objective record that makes it easier for everyone to represent, to Robinson's point. Why not have something that's objective. Yeah, it's an opportunity. And I encourage everyone to vote ought to pass. Thank you.
If you know further questions, for everybody's information, we're past the time that the other bill was supposed to start, but the chairman is not back, and we're on the prime sponsor of this other bill. We'll just continue this hearing until the chairman comes back. Mr. Freeman.
Which one?
There's a whole bunch of us.
JP or Ian?
Oh, it's for me and your brothers?
Well,
no, it's
the JP?
That's me.
All right. Oops.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm J.P. Freeman, a.k.a. J.P. Freeman. My real name is Matthew Phillips. I live in Keene. I'm a reporter and correspondent for copblock.org in New Hampshire Regional Copblock and Keene Copblock. I got over 485 videos on the copblock in like 7 different states. I want to testify basically to the good that this bill can do. In fact, I just want to share one story. It's going to be very brief. An officer in Keene was arresting a young lady in a college neighborhood last September, this past September when school opened, and the girl basically accused him of groping her, and an officer sergeant ended up asking me, do you have that video dropped? And I actually gave him my SD card. I actually never got it back. And it actually cleared his name because he didn't grope her during the time of the arrest, and it actually ended up saving his career. I'm pretty well known of vigorously going after police. In fact, I took a lot of flack of it, but I get along with more than not. As far as the Attorney General's office goes, most everything she said that was a concern is a personal concern. I think it came from out of emotion and has nothing to do with the law. In regards to everything she has a concern with is basically covered by other laws. Interfering with government officials, interfering with government administration, that's a law. I know if I'm videotaping a cop or a police officer, I never interfere with their job in the traffic stop. I make sure the traffic stop is clear because I know they're going to hit me with interfering with their job. And it's an unsafe thing, too. And there's also lawful orders and judgment of the police and public officials, and there's also other laws that cover their trespass notices and stuff like that to protect their in-house stuff. Like if two public officials are having a conversation about a young child for DHHS and so forth, which was another one of our concerns, there are confidentiality laws, federal and state, that protect children and protect confidentiality when it comes to medical records and DHHS records that the bill doesn't, get rid of. As far as the good points, I think most police, and I'm only specifically targeting police, I don't have a habit of going after any other official. I've been known to go after and videotape, bailiffs and stuff like that for trying to hinder your First Amendment rights. But they welcome the camera being there. In fact, they feel safer. If you're a lonely cop, a female cop in a corner of Keene, and she's talking to 30 college kids, and all of a sudden a cop walker's there with a camera, you can see that sigh of relief because her backup's not there yet. Mm-hmm. And there's another view of that, too. But that's all I wanted to say. Thank you for letting me speak.
Any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. Ian.
Good afternoon. Thanks for keeping this going. I'm Ian Freeman. I host a radio show called Free Talk Live. I'm one of the bloggers at freekeen.com. I have a lot of experience creating media, and I have had a lot of experience on the streets and in government offices attempting to record government workers, and also on the phone as well. And I have to ask of these various different government bureaucrats who've come and testified against this bill today is, what are they afraid of? Because what I've heard from them, and I just want to answer some of these objections. The Municipal Association guy came in here and he said that, well, two of you reps could be recorded. Well, that's only true if one of you is doing the recording. The way this bill reads, it makes New Hampshire in line with the supermajority of the states. I believe you said 38 other states. This would allow one party to the conversation to record it. It does not allow someone who is not a party to record it. So the reason why the wiretapping laws were created in the first place was the old idea of somebody sitting outside of your house with a pair of headphones, literally tapping into a conversation that you were having. That's the classic definition of wiretapping. Someone who is not a party to the conversation recording that conversation. This bill would not make that legal. That would still be a crime. And so some of the testimony from the government workers in here earlier tried to make it sound like this bill, if it passed, would all of a sudden make it legal to record a conversation that someone was not a party to. That is not the case at all with this piece of legislation. So again, what is it that they have to hide? What's the objection to secret recording? The Attorney General's lady was in here saying that it makes her uncomfortable to know that a conversation might be recorded secretly. Well, again, if she wants notice that someone is recording, that suggests that she would change how she behaves if she was given notice. So if what she's going to do is on the up and up and is honest, then she shouldn't need to be given notice. No one should need to be given notice of recording going on, which is what you have to do today. If I want to record a conversation with a government official, I have to give them notice. But even then, under a strict reading of the current wiretapping legislation, they could still charge me with wiretapping. And they sure have charged people. I'll just tell you a few brief cases.
That's not necessary because we're short of time.
I'm gonna keep it brief. I just want you to just one here. How about one? Two important cases. One, Ademo Freeman. He was recording a call, two calls with school board officials in Manchester, and he was charged with felony wiretapping for this. And he went to jail for a few months for this. And all he did was ask her some questions that should have been, you know, clearly on the record. But the prosecutor in Manchester went after him for that. And Chris David, he's right now facing wiretapping charges out on the seacoast. In his case, he didn't record a conversation with an official. He recorded a conversation with a bouncer outside of a club. So outside, public place, having a conversation that anyone could have heard. But when he posted that video on YouTube, the bouncer, by the way, was threatening him, was what was going on in that video. So the bouncer was threatening him because he was driving for Uber at the time, and there's this whole Uber controversy out there. And so he's been charged. That case has yet to go to jury trial, but that is in the works right now. And so we're talking about locking up a man who just had a baby and has a family, and now he's looking at prison time for that. So there's more of this. I've seen multiple people arrested in the courts, in Cheshire County Courthouse. They've been arrested for recording video openly, not even secretly. There's a standing order in Cheshire County Courthouse from both the Superior and District, because they're both in the same courthouse. Both the Superior and District judges have written a joint order that completely prohibits the recording in public spaces. Now, the excuse they use for this is that you might record the jurors or some minors. Well, this is BS, because if I want to record the jurors or the minors in the courthouse, all I have to do is stand outside, and I can record every single one of them as they go in and they go out. What this really is an order to protect the workers in the court from accountability. And this law would make it so government officials could be held accountable through secret recordings, as well as bad business owners, which was what Daryl was referring to earlier. You cannot do undercover recordings of, you know, scummy business owners. It's illegal for me to go in with a hidden camera into a dishonest business and capture that person on video. So this is a great piece of legislation. Please pass this. Thank you.
I see no other questions. And the chairman is back. So I guess I can continue this past the time. Because the chairman wasn't here and I was the sponsor of the next bill.
Oh, so we're going to kill the next bill.
Great sense of humor.
Treasure it up to you.
I try.
Can we rotate out of here for lunch?
Sure. Yeah, we can. It should be. But the cafeteria closes in about 45 minutes. So
thank you.
You probably need to go get something to eat.
Hey, what's going on?
You're the one that's here talking.
You're the one that was absent.
I'll be done.
Oh, by the way, Laura's left.
All righty, since he's the sponsor of the next bill, I'll just go ahead and keep going until he comes back. How's that sound? All right.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
I'm a hard-headed pain in the butt.
I like that.
Diane Harding.
Okay. All right.
That'll teach you the song.
All right.
Welcome back.
Thanks. I'm speaking on this bill because I've had personal experience with growing into the realization of what recording has done for me and hasn't done for me. When I was really young, I had an altercation with a teacher, so I kind of wish that Miss Mangapudi, I hope I said that right, would have been here for this part. But history teacher, new curriculum with a new type of process they introduced into our school where schooling was visualized so you could go forward based off of your own progress rate. And they introduced tablets to the school, and you had to sign off saying that yes, you'd be responsible to pay a $50 fee if something happened to it, even if someone else broke it. Well, I grew up in a very poor family, so $50 was out of the question, so I didn't sign off on it. And I was probably the only kid at the end of the senior high school year still without a tablet. And this made it extremely difficult for my teachers to regulate my specific type of schooling because all their programs were based off of the software that the tablet could use. So they actually had to basically give me my own curriculum, all paper-based, where I couldn't do anything in the entire classroom, where all my work had to be at home just because I didn't have the tablet. The reason how this comes back to the recording is after I caused, I only had one issue with one teacher, my history teacher, Mr. Helmrich. My grades significantly decreased after this altercation, after he started to have to do more work to change my curriculum. And I went above and beyond what I had to do. I spent 5 hours on a project when all I had to do was basically tell the meaning of a song lyrics based off of the Vietnam War. And I did a whole video presentation, synced it up, wrote an essay on it, and I should have gotten at least a 90. My grade on that project was a 76. And my grades continued to be just barely above failing in that classroom. And I redouble-checked my work with all the facts online. I got papers back that were graded wrong. I brought it to the school superintendent. They finally got it fixed, but for three quarters, it wasn't fixed till fourth quarter, for three quarters I had failing grades because I couldn't prove that a teacher was discriminating against me because I had no way to record him or auditorily prove that, yes, over the phone he was nice with my parents, or to the superintendent of the school he was saying one thing, but in the classroom he was acting another way. So that's, it's not just public officials like police officers or cop officers. It's anybody who has any, basically even me, anyone should be able to be recorded to either protect what you know if you're using it defensively, or to prove that someone is intentionally harming you or your character or your being. Second experience is, even after that, I was 18 years old. I just got my brand new car. My cousin helped me with that. Brand new car, it was kind of a honky junk, no interior, and still nonetheless, just going through the day, riding around, and a police officer pulled us over. And my cousin had gotten into the habit because of his offense that to protect himself, he always wanted to record. And I was like, no, Joey, you don't have to record it. I don't want him to think that we're, you know, intimidating him or making him feel like he's on the spot. I don't. So he finally acquiesced to me and he didn't record the situation. And the police officers were not only rude, accused there of being drugs in the car. It was a brand new car. I'm never smoked, never done alcohol, nothing in my life, I never will. There was absolutely no way there was drugs in this car. There was zero interior, couldn't hide anything. The interior was orange rust, basically, but it just basically passed inspection. And he had us all get out of the car and basically wait for a cop to come search the car. And I felt like I was being illegally searched and seized. And I had no proof of it because I tried to give the benefit of the doubt. After that specific situation, I no longer fight my cousin to record. And we've had zero problems with officers once they're made aware of that they're on recording. And I've even seen an officer's attitude change once you say, oh, by the way, officer, you're on audio and video surveillance. I mean, I've watched an officer go from straight disrespectful, rude, mean, and insultive towards my cousin to, you're all set, you're free to go. I'm sorry, I hope you have a nice day. I don't understand why. I can speculate that there's some issues with what my cousin has done, but no one deserves that, and you should always be able to feel like you're treated the same, especially as becoming rehabilitated back into this world. Thirdly, hopefully I can speak on your behalf.
You may.
All right. My cousin was diagnosed with petite mal seizures as a young kid, and he has ADHD. Severely. I've never met somebody that is so off track. But I love him, and because I love him, I try to help take care of him. I schedule his appointments, and I do all that stuff. Little did I know that I scheduled an EEG for him to try to help diagnose his migraines and try to get all that squared away. I didn't know the date I scheduled was the same day he had to go to parole. You earlier heard about this. My fault. He wasn't intentionally going there with video and audio surveillance, but they wanted to monitor his facial expressions and his audio sounds during his sleep so they could tell if he was having seizures at night. It was my fault that he went there to parole with the EEG on his forehead, and he was cornered into a room, and he was ordered to remove surgical glue off his head that would have ripped his skin. I mean, we're talking about just trying to solve a medical issue, and they're literally verbally assaulting him and intimidating him. He had five officers corner him in a room no bigger than probably 5x8. Something completely not his fault. He couldn't prove, and they said the next time you come in here with an audio or video surveillance equipment, we're lugging you. We're bringing you back to prison. You cannot video record beyond this door. Even though they audio and video record the very room that I sit in when he goes to parole, and they watch the public come in. But the second you go beyond their door, you can't record them. And we're not allowed in with him. That is scary. That is intimidating. And to speak on, against a lady that was previously here, I think her name was Mrs. Rice. I don't know her, but she said it's highly intimidating for her to speak in public or to be recorded. And I understand that. I'm autistic, I have social anxiety. It's completely hard for me to speak on anything public. My face turns red up here, I hate it. And the only reason why I speak here is because I'm passionate about these problems, and I believe they need to be solved, and I believe that this is the correct way to go about fixing our community in a healthy, suggestive way. So I am up here being recorded because it's something I believe in, even with social anxiety, fear of speaking, and a very mild form of autism. So I don't think that is an excuse to not be recorded. I think that if you're honest and you have nothing to hide, you should be able to be recorded, and you should always be able to record yourself to protect yourself. More often than not, we come into problems being, oh, no, I don't want to be recorded, and they hang up. And we can't prove that we even tried. It needs to be passed so that you could, do what you need to do and defend yourself and not face scrutiny for it. And that's basically my testimony.
Thank you.
Any questions?
I see none. Thank you very much. I would just ask people to be as brief as possible because, like I said, we are pretty much behind time. I've got two more bills to hear this afternoon. So.
The sponsor might die of starvation, too.
Why don't you go grab a bite? And if we get to it before you do it, we'll be more than happy to find somebody to introduce it. And Garrett Ian?
Yep. So, like many of the folks that have spoken here today, I too have been here countless times on similar issues and wonder why it is that it takes New Hampshire so long to adjust on something that I see as such a simple, basic freedom issue, the right to document what is around you. As Representative Robertson pointed out, our eyes are flawed, our minds are flawed. We're not going to be able to document and remember things the way a camera can. The amount of journalism that a camera is capable of achieving is far in excess of what I'm capable of doing with my mind. I'm not even going to try to recount the number of times I've had issues with police and authorities trying to stop me from recording, physically taking property from me. I've had police waiting outside my house to steal a camera from me. That case ended up getting dropped. And all of these things, this is the Criminal Justice and Public Safety Committee. Recording is not a threat to anyone's safety. The things that actually hurt people are the job of the Criminal Justice and Public Safety Committee. Recording is by definition a passive activity. Now, there was a lot of fear-mongering from other public officials that spoke on this bill about, well, if people are allowed to record, if it's legal, as it should be, it's a human right, then somehow they'll be stalking people, they'll be in people's homes, they'll be doing all of these things that sound like crimes to me. It sounds like trespassing to be in someone's home without permission. It sounds like trespassing to be in someone's office without permission. So I don't see why there would automatically be recordings of all of these private spaces. If you want your space to be private, you don't bring journalists into them. So considering all of the concerns about this bill, if it needs to be simplified, please do make New Hampshire a one-party consent state, as it should be, as anybody should be able to have their right to record. We're all equals. There should not be classes of people that can record and can't. Under the current law, the police have special exemptions for how they can record us, the public, but of course they might act out if we record them. Please do change the law so that recording is recognized as a right and not a crime. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you. Any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. David Crawford? Hello. Joseph Brooks?
Thank you. Doing a little bit better since I went on and took an anxiety pill. So this should be a little bit more clear and concise. On numerous occasions, I've been pulled over by police officers in brand new rental cars or in my cousin's brand new car, and been told to get out of the car, told that they were going to search my vehicle, that it smelled like drugs in the car. I even had a passenger once confront the officer and say, "That's impossible, sir." And the officer said, "Your friend has a bad attitude. You gonna do something about it?" All of this became non-existent when I put a dash cam on my dash. As my cousin earlier stated, we were pulled over one night coming down Route 11 by a Farmington police officer who came up to my window and had a very rude, disrespectful attitude. And the minute I got a chance to get it out of my mouth, "Excuse me, sir, you're on audio and video recording." His attitude completely changed. He says, "By the way, do you know you have a taillight out?" "Okay, not a problem. Have a nice day, sir." And this is one of the reasons that I feel this bill needs to be passed. Further reasons are the fact that I called my insurance company after my vehicle was vandalized by a neighbor. And my insurance company, I heard in the background, and I could not record. said, "We're not going to, you're not going to record us." Da, da, da. I heard them say, "Oh, I just Googled it. He's a sex offender. Don't pay this claim." I heard those words out of my insurance company's mouth. And I've been paying my insurance company on time for etc. amounts of time, only to be denied a claim. I think that's inadvisable, especially when I made notations with the Franklin Police Department with video proof that my vehicle was being vandalized by my downstairs neighbor, to which the Franklin Police Department stated in my apartment, and if I'd known I could have recorded them in my apartment at the time, I would have been, "Oh, well, other people feel differently," and to which nothing was done. And of course, if I could have then had lack of notification to protect myself from interactions with devices such as this, I would have caught in the threats that my downstairs neighbor had threatened me with, and who had threatened to kill me and spit in my face, and therefore I would have been able to prosecute him and put him off of the streets. But the Franklin Police Department feel differently about it. That's all I have to say. Any questions?
I see none. Thank you, Ray. The last card I have is Howard Zippel, and I think Howie is not here.
Could I speak? I'll be very brief.
Okay, you should have filled out a pink card.
I'm sorry, I didn't turn it in on time.
Okay, thank you. Make it quick, because we've got, as I indicated, we're already 35 minutes past when we should have started the other bill.
All right, so good afternoon. I'm James Cleveland. In the summer of 2014, I was arrested while recording police and charged with disorderly conduct and resisting arrest. Luckily, I had both a camera and an audio recorder. The audio recorder was running in my pocket, so the police turned off the camera, but the audio kept going. Now, I guess it's unclear to me whether that was legal or not. You know, I don't know, but, so basically in the court during the trial, it was my testimony versus five police officers. Now, the jury found me not guilty, and I believe it's because of that audio recording. I was able to collaborate my story with what I was saying and have an objective record. I said, "Well, you know, don't believe me, let's listen to the audio recording." You know, there's a legal concept of best evidence. And I think that you need to pass this bill to give citizens the tools to collect the best evidence. Another thing I mentioned, Article 8, I could be wrong, but it says the public servants are at all times accountable. You know, there's lots of jobs where people are recorded. I've had plenty of those jobs myself. You know, it just comes with the job, is what I would say. And the final thing I'd say is, I could be mistaken, but I believe that all the citizens who have spoken here today have been in support of this bill, and all the people that have worked for the government have been against the bill. And I think that really says something, that, you know, people feel strong enough to come out here and spend their time and energy. You know, we're not being paid to come out here. So I guess that's it. Thank you very much.
Any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. We have looks like Daryl Perry signed in favor. Representative Hinch signed in opposed. Elizabeth Sargent signed in opposed. David Crawford, Pat Wallace, who's already spoken here, are in favor. Sponsor is in favor. Mike Silva, Representative Silva is in favor. Some of these names I can't read for the handwriting.
Are they in favor or opposed?
They're all pro. There's only one other one, which is Brian Hawkins, who is the State Employees Association, is against it. Will Anderson, Elizabeth Edwards, Garrett Ian, Carla, Gracie, they're all in favor. So I'll close the hearing on House Bill 1546. Yeah, probably will be subcommittee.